Good evening, everybody. Bruchim Haboyim to tonight's broadcast. Tonight we have a special show sponsored by True Torah Jews, Natroino organization. True Torah Jews is an independent organization based out of Brooklyn. Its mission is to bring Torah true views to the public, especially views that they usually don't hear. Tonight we're going to be speaking about an important topic that's on everybody's mind. The topic is the upcoming election for President of the United States. Now, Zev Brenner, when he called me to speak to me about the show, he told me, he says, "Rabbi Shapiro, I hear that you're going to be speaking about the elections. I imagine," he says, "that you're going to be speaking about the upcoming New York elections." So I told him, we're not speaking about the candidates. We're not going to be endorsing any candidates. We're not going to be speaking about one candidate over the other. Instead, I told him, we're going to be speaking about something very important that people don't know, namely, which country we're going to be electing a president for. Because if you speak about to speak to people, especially in the Jewish community, it sounds like the elections are not going to be for President of the United States, but rather President of the State of Israel. President of the United States is the most important position, the most important job in the entire world. There is no more important office on this planet than the office of the President of the United States. And yet, if you speak to people in the Jewish community, what you're going to hear is that, well, we want to vote for so-and-so, this candidate, because this candidate is better for Israel. Or we don't want to vote for this candidate because this candidate is not strong enough on Israel. We're going to speak tonight about the Torah view on how much or what role a candidate's view on Israel should play in our vote for him. The Torah tells us that Jews are obligated to be loyal citizens of the countries that they live in. The Navi Yirmiyah told the people that they should be loyal to their country and that they should pray for its welfare. And besides the Torah's instructions for us, common sense and simple midas tell us that Jews living in the United States of America should be extremely grateful for the wonderful country that we live in. From the beginning of the Bris Hoylem, creation of the world, until today, there hasn't been a country ever as great to the Jews as the United States of America. Even today, where in the world could a person live that gives us as much freedom to practice our religion as the United States of America? I remember, those of you who are old enough to remember the Vietnam War, the country never even tried to draft yeshiva guys. We didn't have to make protests against drafting yeshiva guys. It used to be that it was very, very hard for a person to keep Shabbos because somebody hired you. You came, you didn't show up Shabbos, then you got fired and had to find another job on Sunday. Nowadays, it's illegal not to hire somebody because he keeps Shabbos. It's a wonderful thing living here in the United States of America. And we are grateful citizens to the country, and United States of America is the nation to which we're loyal. Unfortunately, about 150 years ago, maybe 200 years ago, a bunch of degenerate Jews, or people from Jewish stock, came up with a idea to change all that. We Jews, until then, were considered ourselves citizens of the countries that we lived in, various countries in Golos, and our Jewishness was because we practiced the Jewish religion, Judaism. We were members of Polish nation, or the German nation, or the Russian nation, but as far as religion is concerned, we were Jews. Now, a couple hundred years ago, there were Jews that wanted to change that. The reason they wanted to change that is because they weren't happy with the Jewish religion. They didn't like being frum. They considered the Jewish religion something disgusting, degrading, onerous and repugnant. So first they tried to assimilate amongst the Gentiles. The Gentiles wouldn't allow them to assimilate. The Gentiles pushed back. We have a rule that the more Jews try to assimilate, the more the Gentiles push back. And this is from Hashem to try to tell the Jews that they shouldn't be assimilating, they should be Jews. But these Jews didn't take the message that way. The message from Hashem, when the anti-Semites pushed back at their attempt to assimilate into Goyish society, to become Goyim. In particular, in Russia, in the end of the 19th century, there were terrible, terrible pogroms. These Jews decided that the reason why there was anti-Semitism is not because they were abandoning their Jewishness, but rather because they were not Goyish enough. Instead of Jewishness being a religion, they wanted Jewishness to be a nationality. There's a Polish nationality, a Russian nationality, Bulgarian nationality, and they wanted a Jewish nationality. So they created a movement called Zionism. This Zionism portrayed the Jewish people not as religious members of various countries throughout Golus, but rather as a nation in and of themselves. The fact is, the Jewish people are not a nation in the political sense, not in the slightest. The Jews didn't have a common land, we didn't have a common language, and we didn't have a common culture. We had a common religion. And as Rav Sajigoin says, it's only the religion that makes us Jews. What makes an Italian is Italy, perhaps the Italian language and maybe the Italian culture. What makes a Jew is only the Torah. Those people that were at Har Sinai together, those people became, at Har Sinai, the Jewish people. Hayom hazeh niyesa la'om. And when we say the Jews are an Am Yisrael, a Jewish nation, we don't mean that they're the same type of nation that the Greeks or the French or the Canadians are. We mean a religious community. The Zionists wanted to change that. To them, the Jews are a nationality. The Jews are a nation. The problem is, the Jews have no national symptoms. They don't have a common land, no common language, no common culture. So the Zionists who wanted to do this created them. First, they created a national language. That's Ivrit. Ivrit is not Lashon HaKodesh. It's not the language that the Torah is written in. It's completely different, although obviously it's designed to have artificial Lashon HaKodesh flavoring and artificial Lashon HaKodesh coloring. But it's not Lashon HaKodesh. There are very few roots in Ivrit that are Lashon HaKodesh. In fact, there are many words in Ivrit that are designed specifically to make the Jews understand that they're not a religion, and that the Jewish religion is bogus. For example, the phrase that we have in Lashon HaKodesh, Keren Kayemes, is used only in one context. It's used in a context of merits that we accumulate for the next world. In modern Hebrew, in Ivrit, Keren Kayemes is the Jewish National Fund. The word Kavyochel, which means so to speak, in Lashon HaKodesh is used only in one context. You will only find it in regard to Hashem. It means that when we refer to Hashem as Hashem spoke, Hashem did, Hashem went, it doesn't mean literally that Hashem spoke or did or went. It means kaviyochel, in a manner of speaking. Today, in modern Hebrew, kaviyochel means haha, as if. Of course, all of these phrases, these modern Hebrew expressions, were designed specifically to mock the commonality that the Jews had, meaning their religion. The word agadah or agoda to us in Lashon HaKodesh means those parts of the Torah that are not halacha. Today in Israel, agoda means legends or fiction. This was done on purpose. But it was very important for the Zionists for us to that we should speak Ivrit. because that was really, at that point in time, the only thing that they could claim to be a national characteristic. Afterwards, they worked on getting a land, a country, a state of Israel, and they succeeded, which is unfortunate. The state of Israel became a country in a way that no other country was formed. The state of Israel became a country in a very strange way. Normally, when a group of people get together in a self-determination movement or a national liberation movement, the people who are involved with the movement become the citizens of the country that results from the movement. For example, the United States of America was created because the colonists here in the North America wanted to break off from Great Britain, and they did. Those colonists that broke off from Great Britain, they were the citizens of the United States of America. Israel did something different. When Israel became a country, they laid the claim to become the country, the nation state, of not the Israelis and not the Zionists that were involved with creating Israel, but rather of all the Jews around the globe. In the Middle East, there was a little country, a little piece of land, and the Zionists who turned that land into a country, they claimed that that country now became the country of all the Jews around the world, the Jews in the United States of America, the Jews in Europe, the Jews in the Middle East, the Jews in Arab countries. That's a very strange thing, and it's different than any other country that was created. When Poland was created, when the Czech Republic was created, when Italy was created, when the United States of America, Canada, or Mexico were created, they were created for those that created, for those that were involved with the movement to create the country. Israel claimed that they are not only an independent country, not only are the Zionists now independent, but they represent the entire Jewish population all over the world. How did they do that? What makes Israel the nation state of people that never visited it, never planned on visiting it, lived, let's say, in the United States of America, lived, let's say, in Russia? Imagine that. In 1948, these people in the Middle East create a country. And they create a country, and now suddenly, if you are born Jewish in the United States or in Canada, that is now your nation state. That's nonsensical, and that's absurd. But that's what Zionism did. Or that's what it claims to have done. The truth is, Theodor Herzl himself claimed a legal right to represent all the Jews all over the world. He invoked some ancient Roman law, negatorium gestio, I believe it's called, that if you have a group of people or a person that has nobody to represent them, you're allowed to step in and represent those people. So the Zionists came, created a nation state in the name of all the Jews of the world. Now, this is a tremendous problem. It's a tremendous problem because, take me for example, I'm a citizen of the United States of America. I was born here. I was born in this town, Brooklyn, New York, where we're broadcasting from. And suddenly, I grow up and I'm told, I'm informed by the media, I'm informed by the Israeli government, I'm informed by the local modern Orthodox synagogues, I'm informed by the Zionist press, I'm informed by all of these people that I have a country. It's called Israel. That's my nation state in the Middle East. How in the world did that become my country? Now, this is a terrible thing. Not only did I not ask that Israel should represent me, that it should be my nation state, but what happens is that my fellow countrymen here in the United States of America look at me as a fifth column. If I, as a United States citizen, have a nation state in the Middle East, tell me, who am I supposed to be loyal to? The country that I was born within its borders, the United States of America, or the nation state of all the Jewish people, state of Israel? One of the biggest objections to Zionism, both from Orthodox Jews and from non-Orthodox Jews, was that it's immoral and unethical to create a state of Israel because it unfairly casts citizens, Jewish citizens, of all countries all over the world as fifth columns, as people with dual loyalty. Jonathan Pollard's wife, for example, had an interview which was recorded in the Jewish Week, I believe. And they asked her if she regrets, this was the first wife, they asked her if she regrets spying on the United States of America, and she said, no, we did our duty as Zionists. I did not ask, and I have no interest, and I do not accept the state of Israel as my state. It's not a question of, well, I'm against their policies. I'm calling them out as a fraud. Israel is not the state of the Jewish people all over the world. Israel is the state of the Israelis. Israel doesn't want to accept that. Israel wants to be the state of the Jewish people, and Zionists don't want to accept that. But what happens is, if you do accept that, is that now you, growing up as a citizen of the United States of America, now must take the interests of the state of Israel into consideration, perhaps more so, logically more so, than the country in which you live. And that's why we have Jews that, when they vote for president of the United States of America, their primary concern is, what does this candidate think about Israel? What does this candidate think about my country? This creates a problem for all Jews. It's a problem that we must deal with. And it's a problem that manifests every election, every time we have to elect a president of the United States. What is his policy on Israel? What is his policy on Israel? What is his policy on Israel? Here's news for all the Zionist Jews. We are not electing the president of Israel. We are electing the president of the United States of America. Those who base, when they vote for the president of the United States, on so many issues that exist, consider first and foremost, what is this man's position on Israel? And if you like his position on everything else, but he's not strong enough on Israel, then not only are you not going to vote for him, he's a traitor to the people, he's not really Jewish, and various different types of insults are hurled at him. He becomes a traitor to the Jewish people. Benzin Netanyahu came to America not long ago, and he announced before he came that he's coming representing the entire Jewish people, not only the state of Israel. He's coming to represent the entire Jewish people. How did Benjamin Netanyahu come to represent the entire Jewish people? How did Benjamin Netanyahu come to represent me? Did I elect him? Do I want him to represent me? What connection do I have with him? I believe in the Torah. I'm Jewish. What in the world does Benjamin Netanyahu have? What qualifications does he have that he claims to represent me? And it's not only him. Naftali Bennett and various other high-level Zionists say all the time that the state of Israel represents all the Jewish people, and Benjamin Netanyahu is the prime minister, this is the words they use, of all the Jews. You know, they say Israel claims to be the only true democracy in the Middle East. Well, maybe in the Middle East it's a democracy. But I know that I was born a Jew, and without electing anybody in the Middle East, a man from Israel claims to be my leader, to represent me. I didn't vote for him. He didn't ask me. Just because I'm born Jewish, I'm born and Netanyahu represents me. I don't think that's a democracy. That sounds like a dictatorship. If I don't like Barack Obama or whoever's going to win the next election, and I want to move out of the country, I can move out of the country. But if I move out of the United States because I'm Jewish, I can't escape Benjamin Netanyahu's claim to represent me. I moved to Canada and Netanyahu still represents me. I moved to Mexico. Israel still claims to be my nation state. That's a dictatorship. Somebody foists themselves on me. No, I represent you. We're your country. We're your representatives. Whether you like it or not, you have no voice in this. This is immoral. This is unfair. This is unethical. And this casts the Jewish people in a disloyal light, rightfully so. But the truth is, real Jewish people who really understand what Jewishness is. Jewish people are loyal to their countries. We are loyal to the United States of America, despite what Israel is telling everybody, despite what people like Jonathan Pollard and his wife tell people, despite the Naftali Bennett's, Jews are 100% loyal to their country. If the Jews are called upon to fight for their country, they will fight for their country. We are citizens of the United States of America, loyal to the United States, just as any other citizens of the United States of America. Israel's claim to be the nation-state of the Jewish people is a fraud. There is no such thing as a nation-state of the Jewish people. The Jewish people are a religion. Religions don't have nation-states. Nationalities do. And if you want to see what kind of fraud Israel's claim to represent the Jews is, just ask a Jew. Just ask a Jew what he means when he says that he requires his candidate to be pro-Israel. Here's a question. Is pro-Israel the same as being pro-Jewish? I'd like somebody from the audience to tell me, as a Jew, why do they think that a candidate that's pro-Israel is also pro-Jew. Israel is a country, and they have interests, like all countries do. And the Jewish people have interests, like all groups of people do. What makes you think that the policies of Israel, the interests of Israel, and the interests of those candidates that are pro-Israel correspond with the interests of the Jewish people? For example, let's take two issues. Let's take the issue that's on the table now of the settlements. A candidate that wants to disallow Israel to continue building settlements is considered an anti-Israel candidate, or at least in that regard. Issue number two. There was recently a Supreme Court case, Zivotofsky versus Kerry, where a young man that had a passport where his place of birth was listed as Jerusalem brought a lawsuit because he wanted his place of birth to be listed as Israel. The United States does not recognize Jerusalem as part of Israel, and to the Zionists, Jerusalem is its capital. The United States puts Jerusalem as the place of birth of those people that are born in Jerusalem. Case went to the Supreme Court. They ruled, like the President of the United States, that the place of birth will remain Jerusalem and not Israel. When President Obama sided with the current law that the place of birth should be Jerusalem, he was condemned as being anti-Israel. Now imagine some candidate that says he will not recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel and he wants to prohibit Israel from building more settlements, and he wants to get rid of the old ones even. Such a candidate is certainly anti-Israel. Now, question, is such a candidate anti-Jewish? Is being anti-settlement anti-Jewish? It's anti-Israel. Well, let's see. Do the settlements benefit the Jews in any way? Well, the Zionists say they do. Does it ensure the safety of Jews in any way? No. What it does actually is puts Jews in danger. If you want to protect the safety of the Jewish people, then what are you doing with settlements? I'm quoting you from the Sefer, Mechtovim U'Maimorim of Rav Shach, Chelek Aleph, it's page Yud Beis. He says that there's a big difference between Zionism and Judaism. And for example, you can see the difference when we talk about the settlements. Inyan ha'hisnachus yechiach. Shizehu his goras gasa bu'umois ha'olam. The settlements is merely serves to antagonize, and it's a form of aggression, aggressiveness against other nations. V'hu noiveyim ha'tois ha'yisoydi shel ha'tzioinim. It stems from the fundamental mistake of the Zionists. Shel adaitam kol masha over aleinu hurak b'mnei shloi ha'yolanu medina v'shulten mishalonu. That the more strong we show that we are, the better off we will be. But that's not the Jewish way. The Jewish way is to protect Jewish lives. Now, the settlers in the settlements are in danger. They know they're in danger. And not only that, but all it does is cause conflict. All the settlements do is cause conflict. There is no physical purpose of the settlements. It's a Zionist purpose. And if somebody wants to protect the Jews, or if somebody holds like Rav Shach, and surely it's not only Rav Shach, every Gadol B'Yisrael agrees with this, your candidate is anti-Israel. If you want to protect Jewish lives, and you're against these settlements, like our Gadolei Yisrael are, because to our religion, Jewish, a life, a human life, is worth more than anything else, not to mention the fact that all these things do is cause friction and antagonism. It serves no humane purpose. Then guess what? You are pro-Jew, but in this aspect, you're anti-Israel. Now, the Zivotofsky case. Can anybody explain to me how and why putting Israel on somebody's passport instead of Jerusalem saves Jewish lives? How does it protect any Jews? What benefit do we Jews in America, or even the Jews in Israel, have? That is a Zionist ideological thing. It has nothing to do with helping Jewish people. It's an Israeli Zionist ideological thing. If you are a Jew, what in the world difference does it make to you if it says on somebody's passport Jerusalem or if it says Israel? If the United States of America, if your country, who you are obligated to be loyal to, does something, it doesn't harm you in the slightest, and it considers it in their best political and international interests. How dare you as a Jew? How dare you as an American citizen? Go out and try to rebel against your country because of the interests of some foreign government. The pro-Jewish stand would be to support the United States of America. Keep Jews safe. We don't need to be involved in international conflicts. pro-Israel politicians are telling people to leave Europe and come to Israel because there's anti-Semitism in Europe. Now, let's see if this works. I want to play you an interview with Nathan Sharansky. He used to be called Anatoly Sharansky when I was a kid. Nathan Sharansky is one of the directors of the Jewish Agency, which is in charge of this whole Aliyah project to transport Jews from France to Israel. Vox News asked Nathan Sharansky, isn't it a bit crazy to transport Jews or to tell Jews to leave France to come to Israel because it's unsafe in France? The reason why it's crazy is because there is no more dangerous place for Jews currently in the world than the state of Israel. There are more Jews killed there since 1948 than anywhere else in the world. They're always complaining about existential threats, missiles raining down on their head. It's a terrible, terrible thing. It's tragic. And we cry for that. And we pray and do whatever we can for their safety. But I, in the United States of America, never had to run into a bomb shelter. My president is not running around begging other countries to help because of existential threats. I'm not worried about North Korea. I'm not worried about Iran. It's dangerous over there. So they asked Mr. Sharansky, isn't it a bit crazy to tell Jews to come to Israel? Let's see if this will play.
Do you understand why that, in a way, seems sort of crazy from an outside perspective to leave a place like Paris because it's unsafe and then to move to Israel?
Now listen to Sharansky's answer.
France has great laws against anti-Semitism. But it's not about laws and it's not about physical protection. It's about whether you can feel yourself comfortable, secure at home. And they find out that they feel themselves much more at home when they come to Israel.
Coming to Israel is not about physical protection. It's about feeling at home. It's about feeling secure, not about being secure. Listen to what this man is saying. He's saying that Israel is not safer than France. In fact, France is safer than Israel on the whole. But you feel safer in Israel, you feel more at home. So because of a fake feeling of security, why in the world do they feel at home, feel safe, if they're not safe there? It's an ideological thing. They're taking Jews and putting them in a more dangerous situation for ideological reasons. If you are pro-Jew, you will tell Jews to go to wherever it is safest for them, and I'm not even talking about ruchniyistika safety. I'm not even talking about spiritual safety. I'm not talking about what they're going to do to the Yemenite kids that they airlift to Israel. I'm talking about simple physical safety, simple issue of anti-Semitism, simple issue of protection. What Sharansky says, the Ayatollah Sharansky, that it's not about physical safety. I say it is about physical safety. If you are pro-Jew, you should care about their safety. If you are pro-Israel, you're going to care about ideology, even if it costs Jews their lives. And it's not just Mr. Sharansky. It's our Rabbonim as well. Every person, and not only the Rabbonim, everybody that has a little common sense in his head. I have over here in front of me, recently there came out this publication, a Torah publication called Dialogue. And in it, there's a little article from the Rosh Hashiva of Ner Yisrael, Rabbi Aaron Feldman. Rabbi Feldman is responding to a fellow in Los Angeles that wrote some Zionist things in the previous issue of this publication. Rabbi Feldman says that today's Zionists are very interested in the in the good of the Jews. And he mentions about how Netanyahu invites all France's Jews to come home to Israel. And I quote from Rabbi Feldman. This invitation, Netanyahu's invitation to French Jews to come home to Israel, is, quote, nothing more than a vain boast. Given the impending threat of a nuclear Iran, Israel is, in the long run, much more dangerous to Jews than France. And even on a daily basis, Israel is at least as ineffectual as France in stopping the killing of Jews by Arabs. If you are pro-Jew, if you care about your brothers, you're not going to support the idea to airlift them, to encourage them to go from a more safe place to a less safe place for some Zionist ideological reasons. I don't know what religion it is to say that Jews should risk their lives, but it's certainly not Judaism. Now, the pro-Israel ideology, the Zionist ideology, is in fact that if there is a conflict between Israel and Jewish lives, Israel comes first. I want to quote you something from Rabbi Herschel Schechter. We heard from the Rosh Hashiva of Ner Yisrael. Now we're going to hear from a Rosh Hashiva in Yeshiva University. Rabbi Herschel Schechter, in an article I have in front of me, Journal of Halacha and Contemporary Society, discusses Israel's wars. And he discusses why Israel is halachically permitted to go to war for land. Not to save lives. To save lives is an entire different discussion. But to go to war in order to protect land. The halacha is that Jews would be mechal Shabbos 1,000 times if there's a 1% chance of saving one life by doing so. Going to war to save land would seem inconsistent with our values. And I quote, here's what he says, listen to this. In addition, says Rabbi Schechter, it would appear that at the heart of our preparedness to fight for Eretz Yisrael is the fact that Israel's role today is as the national home of the Jewish people. Since a nation's land is vital to its existence as a nation state, to the point that in various contexts, limited contexts, only those Jews residing in Eretz Yisrael are considered full members of Klal Yisrael, conquest by a foreign power is considered a lethal blow to the essence of the conquered nation. Therefore, just as a doctor would amputate a patient's limb in order to save a life, when the life of an entire nation is endangered, it is permissible to sacrifice the lives of a few for the purpose of sparing the nation at large. Again, listen to what he's saying. He's not saying that they can go to war to protect lives. He's saying that because Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people, if Israel would not exist, the Jewish nation, the Jewish people, would not exist. And in order to protect this concept of the Jewish nation, Israel is allowed to go to war and have Jewish children shechted and murdered and killed in war for some nationalistic goal. What's the mucker for this? You know he doesn't bring any mucker for that. But I know the mucker. The mucker is David Ben-Gurion. In the olden days when the Zionists were fighting the British, and they're fighting the Arabs and they were fighting the British, and there was a whole three wars, the early 1930s. There were those Zionists, there were two groups, the Bris Shalom group and even the Shomer HaTzoyer group that wanted, instead of fighting with the Arabs, they wanted a binational state, something that comes up now, but it came up then. Judah Magnus, the big Zionist, was most prominent on that side. Ben-Gurion said that he will not have such talk. He would rather fight and have people die to have a Jewish nation state, because without a Jewish nation state, there is no nation. And anybody that speaks about having a Klal Yisrael without a Medina is putting the entire nation of the Jews in danger. It's not only him. There are many Zionists that said that, as far as I know, he was the first. This is Rabbi Schechter's source. And now we're going to hear from the cream of the crop of the Zionist Rosh Hashivas, Rabbi Shlomo Aviner. Rabbi Aviner also addresses the fact that in the settlements it's not safe. Not safe doesn't mean, yeah, it's true. There are people that get killed in five towns. There are people that get killed everywhere. If you tell somebody, well, if your child would tell you, well, you know what, I'm going to go into a dangerous neighborhood in the middle of the night, a drug-infested neighborhood, a war zone. You know, I'm going to go to Syria. I want to travel to Syria on vacation for Bein Azmanim. And when you tell him it's dangerous, he'll say, well, you know what? People get killed in Brooklyn too. That's a moron. Well, in Tel Aviv, they also get killed. It's the difference between there and the settlements. Now listen to what Rabbi Shlomo Aviner says about the settlements. Listen to this. We've all, quote, there's a, in his website, RavAviner.com or something to that effect, and was also reprinted in the Jewish press. Quote, we have already been living in Yesha for 40 years, and the numbers that of murders that occur there are extremely low. The same is true in all of Eretz Yisrael. We must remember that according to a report of the World Health Organization, 8 out of 100,000 Israeli citizens are murdered each year. That's compared with 15 out of 100,000 citizens in France and 25 out of 100,000 citizens in America. Therefore, quote, it is more dangerous for the Admor of Satmar to live in America than to live in the settlements. Now, that's a quote from this man. Tell me this man is not a Russia for twisting numbers to try to convince people to put put their lives in danger. Yes, it's true, 100% true. But you know what that means? That means, let's take the borough of Queens, where I live. So Queens has some safe neighborhoods. They have some dangerous neighborhoods. Jamaica's crazy, right? They have dangerous neighborhoods. America has some dangerous neighborhoods. But if you're not in a drug den, if you're not in a crazy neighborhood, if you live in a normal place, then that 25 out of 100,000 would not apply to you. That skews the numbers. And average, if you have people making $200,000 a year and another person making $0 a year, the average of that population is $100,000 a year. It represents nobody. Shlomo Aviner is purposely trying to convince people. Do you hear what he says? The settlements are safer than Monroe because of the statistics all over America. A man like that, that puts Jews' lives in danger and asks Jews to put themselves in danger, trying to convince them that it's safe, that's even worse than Sharansky. At least Sharansky admitted Israel's dangerous. This is Zionism. Jews are loyal citizens to the countries where they live. If you want to know what candidate to vote for a candidate that has the interests, the best interests of the United States of America in mind. And if you're interested in your cousins or your brothers or your fellow Jews or your fellow human beings, but if you're interested in your fellow Jews, then forget about pro-Israel candidates. Look for pro-Jewish candidates. Look for candidates that are going to make Jews safer in Israel, not candidates that are going to shecht Jews, allow Jews to be slaughtered because of some Zionist ideology. Look for candidates that are against settlements. Look for candidates that will not have Jews blamed for antagonizing nations by insisting that Jerusalem be considered the capital of Israel. This does not help any Jews. It does not help any human beings. All it does is further the Zionist ideology. I asked the guy in the street, do you want to vote for a pro-Israel candidate? Yes. Well, do you know all our Gedolei Israel are against the settlements? Yes. Well, then you want a candidate that's against settlements. You want an anti-Israel candidate. Do you know that it only serves to antagonize people to make Jerusalem the capital of Israel? Well, yes, of course, it doesn't serve any purpose. Then you want an anti-Israel candidate. Anti-Israel candidate doesn't mean that you want to harm any people. Certainly not any Jews in Israel. Anti-Israel means that they're against whatever policies in Israel hurts Jews. Whatever policies in Israel put Jews in danger. The Zionist ideology is that Jews should be sacrificed for the national interests. Ben-Gurion, we saw that from Herschel Schechter. We saw that from Shlomo Aviner. That's their religion. Their religion says, send Jews from Paris to Israel, even though it's more dangerous. And you know what? Prepare places for them in the settlements. They interviewed people in the settlements, and they said, yes, we know our children are in danger. But it doesn't matter, because we're living in the settlements. This is so against every value that Jews have in every... And when I say Jews, I don't mean Jews as a nationality or an ethnicity. There is no such thing. I mean Jews, the Torah values, our religious values. And it's so against regular, normal, humanistic values, and it's against common sense. Forget about pro-Israel. Forget about anti-Israel. None of that, in and of itself, is useful. What is important is pro-Jew. And what I mean pro-Jew means our values, our religious values. People that are going to save lives and not sacrifice lives for some Zionist ideals. I'm not telling you who these candidates are. I myself don't know. But this is what we should be looking for. Domestic issues. What, you care about education, healthcare, like any American citizen. We are American citizens, for crying out loud. We have the same interests as theirs. Yes, we're religious, so we have interests for, we have religious interests as well, like all religious groups, that's fine. But the pro-Israel is not only wrong from a Jewish perspective, because we're American citizens and not Israeli citizens, and the interests of a foreign country should never, ever, ever take precedence over the interests of ours. But not only that, these particular interests of the foreign country are not in accordance with our values. Some are, some aren't, like any other country. It's an illusion to vote for somebody because he's pro-Israel, because if you think about it a little below the surface, pro-Israel doesn't at all mean pro-Jew. It doesn't mean at all pro-our values. It doesn't mean humanistic values. It doesn't mean Jewish values. We have to look for people that have our values, whatever your values may be. Israel certainly does not share all the Jewish values. Neither does France, neither does England. But the only difference is Israel claims to represent the Jews. We Jews are loyal United States citizens with many religious values. Above and beyond almost anything else, we value life. And that value of life is in direct conflict with many of the policies and values of Zionism and the State of Israel. Have a gute Nacht.